Good. I'd like to welcome everybody to today's school board meeting. It is October 11th, 2005, and I get to be the chair tonight. I am the designated school board speaker of the House, I think, because I'm third in line. Kevin Sweeney is in Italy until next week, and Ann Belden has just returned this afternoon from a very rainy leadership training seminar up in Newry, Maine. So she's recuperating at this point, so I've stepped forward. I'd like to start this evening's meeting with the Pledge of the Allegiance. Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. We have a couple of adjustments to the agenda this evening.
I do. A couple of last-minute things that came in. The first one is for Agenda Item 12A for athletic fee recommendations is an added one from the one that you got before. And the other one is to Agenda Item 12G, which is consideration of approval of an additional halftime educational ed tech 2 in special education. And I will add those to that specific part of the agenda when we get to it.
Okay.
Yes.
Yes.
I don't know whether you want to do that to move field trip requests to the beginning. Yes, he's here. To the beginning of the agenda.
Yes, I think that's a good idea. We have some faculty members here to speak to the field trip, so why don't we move those items, number 12D.
And 11A.
And 11A to follow after the report from the high school and middle school students. And then we'll take a vote during the normal time, but we'll have the presentations at that time. I'd also like to add an item under the superintendent's report, which would be 8C, in which Alan will share with us some of the information regarding his trip as part of Project Blueprint. And then also under new business, we need another item in which we will have a motion, or hopefully a motion, to confirm the adoption of the athletic co-curricular committee. And I will report during the committee reports about what our plans are, but we will need to pass that as an approved standing committee. So that would be item GF. Any others? Okay. We all received in our packet the September school board minutes. Are there any comments or questions?
Yes. We need to adjust under 10 policy IGA.
Page 2C.
Yes, page 2C. It's written that it was approved 6-0, and I believe actually we approved postponing, delaying the vote. And also under IHOA, page 2D, it's the last item, field trips and excursions. I believe also that was postponed for further information. That's it for me.
Any other questions regarding that? Anne's probably aware that they're continuing to work on those, so we'll just make the changes in there. There was just one other change, that the meeting was held at 7:30 p.m. I think we need to just change them all to 7, while we're doing that. Any other changes? No? Can I have a motion?
I move that we approve the minutes as amended.
Second?
A second.
All those in favor? That would be five of us. Thank you. All right. Moving on to communications. Alan?
Yes, a couple of things that I want to mention this evening. First of all, you may have seen in the newspapers, although they haven't done a lot of work on it yet, that there is a process going on from the Department of Education now. It's called the School Administrative Unit Review Process. And what they're basically doing is they're sending out teams from the Department of Education to each school system in the state to review where we are with the work that we've been doing around assessment and the learning results. The date for Cape Elizabeth is November 7th. It will be a full day process. The administrative team will be tied up in that. Also, our teaching staff will all receive, hopefully, I don't know if they've come today or not, but they, okay, I see they haven't yet, but they're supposed to be coming soon, a survey that they are supposed to complete and are given self-addressed stamped envelopes to send it back, also to give some feedback on the assessment process and the local assessment system that we've worked on. So that will happen on November 7th. I think we are, other than the school systems that were used as the first round of this, I think we're one of the first school systems to be done. I would mention that Sarah Simmons, who is our curriculum director, has been out today to get training in order to do some of these visits herself. But the visiting teams will be made up of people from the Department of Education and volunteers from across the state. The second one that I have is SAT versus MEA at grade 11. And Jeff, you may want to speak to this too, but what I would say briefly is certainly it has received a lot of play in the newspapers. There's been a decision by the Department of Education to replace the grade 11 MEAs, which we've done for many years, with the SATs. Certainly, I've had conversations with Jeff and also with the State Department. For Cape Elizabeth, I think probably this will be a good move because we tend to have approximately 92% of our students who take the SAT anyway. And so it will be a required test. So we will be under the same guidelines as MEA is as far as attendance, participation, and also based on information about subgroups. But that I think for us, although there are questions about several aspects of this, I think for us it will work well for us. It will be an SAT on a Saturday, I believe it's April 1st, if I'm not mistaken, with a makeup session that next week and Tuesday. Some questions that are floating around out there. Number one, cost is supposed to be borne completely by the Department of Education, therefore by state government. The second question is whether that will be counted as a school day or not, an answer which I have not received. And the third piece was transportation, and whether we will provide bus transportation on those days, since it is now a requirement that all students participate. Latest that I've heard is that the state is looking at now providing the cost of the transportation, and so that we probably will be doing that. But there are many more questions to be answered, and so stay tuned along with us. We'll stay tuned as well to see how it all plays out. The other piece that I think is going to be a major question is the prep programs that a lot of students are involved with, where parents pay good money to prep them for the SATs, because the SATs are extremely important for students as they apply for colleges. There is some question out there about what will happen in this case, where you'll have some students across the state who have come from families who honestly do that, and then you have other families who cannot afford it. And so there is going to be that question, which will be another one which will have to be dealt with by the Department of Education before April 1st. So I am very sure that we'll be getting more updates as they come along. I keep the Jeff and the high school people as well informed as possible, and we'll keep you as a board informed as that happens and give you updates monthly, if we have updates monthly, on how this is all going to play out. And those are the two updates that I have at this point for communications.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
Do you know what the targeted score is for exhibiting competency?
What we have asked that question, and I don't know if Jeff has heard anything different. What I have heard most recently is the cut score has not been determined yet, but it supposedly will be determined, but the cut has not been determined. So what they're going to have to do is what they will be looking at, and what they've told us is there will be the exceeds the standard, does not meet the standard, the same types, but they have not, as far as I know at this point, have not determined those cut scores. So there are a lot of things that need to be determined. This is a pretty fast-moving process. Jeff, I don't know if you had anything else you wanted to say about it or not.
I would just sort of briefly speak for myself. I'd echo what Alan says. I think for Cape Elizabeth High School, it's likely to be a good change. I think it does address one concern that I've had about the MEAs ever since we've asked kids to take them, which is we judge schools by the one external standard that kids have no stake in, one way or the other. It makes absolutely no difference to them whether they do well or poorly. So there's always sort of a tremendous amount of skepticism about, you know, what does this true? Is this really a good measure of what kids know and are able to do? So I think this is probably, at least for Cape Elizabeth High School, a step in that right direction. It's not what I personally would like to see as the best model, but at least it's a test that our kids will, without any question, and kids across the state will take seriously. So in that sense, it's a better measure. But it's a good question about cut scores, and I don't know the answer to that question either.
Any other questions regarding communications? It's time for us to welcome our middle school representatives. High school representatives, I forget. Daley Gruen and Connor Hankinson.
All right. So the first thing I was going to talk about was that recently there's been a lot of discussion, you may or may not know, about our dances, especially following this past homecoming dance, which was 2 weeks ago or so. Chaperones and parents have, as long as I can remember, I guess, at least have expressed their concern about the type of dancing at our dances. But recently the issue is kind of blown up, and it's what everyone's talking about. Last year, when it was an issue, the SAC had a big meeting with Mr. Shedd about ways to sort of compromise or resolve this, or just to figure out what was happening. And things, I guess, really haven't gotten better since then. So now we're having more talks, and we're not really sure if we're going to have more dances or not. We usually have another one in the year. I guess at the PTA meeting, I think it was, a lot of parents showed up, especially freshman parents that weren't happy about what had occurred at the dances. So we are having talks with Mr. Shedd, and we're hoping to start roundtable discussion groups, which are kind of like homeroom, except we don't have it in the morning, with all the students in the school about, you know, what sort of appropriate dancing and what we need to do to keep having dances. So hopefully they'll be productive and things will get somewhere.
Also, students have taken a large interest in the effort to reform the substance abuse policy. This is partly spurred by the media coverage, so everyone's all excited. In general, students seem to support the change, which includes separate contracts for separate sports seasons and contracts for all other extracurriculars. This would uphold the mission statement's declaration that all CHS students, not just athletes, will demonstrate ethical and responsible behavior and demonstrate a spirit of cooperation and teamwork in a climate that embraces diversity. On another note, this climate of the school does seem to be on an upswing, maybe because the construction is subsiding and the environment seems more stable.
We both have two things to say. So the other sort of smaller issue I was gonna touch on, fill you in on. Last year there was a really big problem with graffiti in the bathrooms, especially in one bathroom, about one person specifically, and it kind of dwindled out, I guess, towards the end of last year, but this year it reappeared, and Mr. Shedd called a large meeting with all the guys from the sophomore and junior grades about the graffiti and what would happen to the next person who was caught, and just laying out the guidelines for what needs to occur. And since then, it's been gone, I guess. So that's good.
I just want to thank you for bringing the interesting aspects of some of the government of your high school. I know that you're welcome at the policy committee meetings. I've been able to enjoy attending the first of the high school forums, where I've heard from your members on some of the issues that are important to the students. And everybody's well-spoken and thoughtful, and we really appreciate, as a school board, hearing about the issues that make a difference for you guys. And so I'd love to hear more about the roundtables regarding the dances. I know that we'll be continuing to work on the substance abuse so that we can work together.
Okay, thanks.
Thanks. We have two middle school students, Jack Fisher and Will Daly.
Good evening. I'm the school board representative for Cape Elizabeth Middle School, 7th and 8th grade. I'll be reporting tonight. Student council members have been appointed as of late September, and the middle school dance was a complete success. Our net profit was above $800, and of that $800, $100 will be donated to the American Red Cross to help fund the Katrina relief effort. The whole middle school will be taking part in the WMGX food drive, and the collections will begin on November 14th of canned goods and just non-perishables. The 7th grade will be going to Kiev on October 17th through the 21st, and there are currently no community service projects taking place. However, this Friday, each student council member is required to pitch an idea of a fundraiser or charity to support. That's it.
Hi, my name is Will Daly. I'm your other school board rep. So far, we have no scheduled schedules for the 5th and 6th grade, but we're definitely going to get to scheduling those as soon as we can. Sally Foster went very smoothly. We do not have a money tally yet, but it definitely went smoothly, and a lot of people contributed. We donated money for Katrina relief, first by collecting coins throughout the school, and we raised $492 doing that. And then one day we had a hat day where people could donate money and wear a hat for that day, and we raised around $200 for that. And then fall sports were coming to a close, and that includes soccer, cross-country running, field hockey, and tennis, and I'm pretty sure that all of the teams did a great job this year. Thanks.
Thank you very much. It's nice to have another Daly in the crew to replace Nora. At this point, I think we're going to move along to to hear from Ted Jordan and some other field hockey requests. Ted, do you want to come on up first?
Good evening. Am I correct in assuming that everyone's had a chance to look at the email that I sent along? So I don't know how to proceed here. Do you want me to recap the three trips I'm proposing, or do you have specific questions for me?
Yeah. I think it would be a good idea if you could recap the three trips for the public and parents to hear what types of plans you have for the grades.
Okay. I'm going to give these in the order that I hope that they will occur. The first one is for my CP government class. That's seniors, and I have about 36 students. And my proposal is that I will take these 36 or so on an all-day field trip down to the Boston Bureau of the FBI. This will come as the culmination of a law and order unit. We will study some Supreme Court cases from the 1960s that talk about the Miranda rights and illegal search and seizure. We will have, I guess now, former CEPD officer Paul Gaspar in to talk about his expertise in that area. And Paul's kind of uniquely qualified, in addition to having been a local law enforcement officer here in Cape, during the summers, he was a, maybe still is, a customs officer for where the, well, used to be, Scotia Prince is now gone. He was a customs officer where the Scotia Prince would come ashore in Portland, which took on a great deal more significance after 9/11. So he's got a perspective that he can share with the students about both local law enforcement as well as what it's like for international and customs after 9/11. So this all culminates, as I said, in a trip down to the FBI. The agent there who will host us is Pete Bickmore, who's a Maine native, former Scarborough police officer, and now, as I said, an agent in Boston. And he will, again, just further the conversation, taking them to the next level to show them what federal law enforcement is like in the post 9/11 world. So we will, if approved, charter bus, leave in the morning, miss the day of school, and return home about 4 in the evening. Paul Gaspar has graciously volunteered to chaperone with me, which I think is encouraging to everyone. So that's the first one. Do you have questions about that, or do you want me to keep right on rolling?
Any questions regarding this trip?
I mean, I would just say as a last note on that, I think it's especially important for young people this age to see these law enforcement officers maybe in a different context, in the context of the classroom or, in the case of the FBI trip, visiting their bureau, as opposed to maybe some other context which young people may meet police officers in. The second trip I'm proposing would be for, again, seniors. This would be an honors and CP economics class, and this would probably be 20 to 25 students. And this one would be during the second semester. This is a trip that I have also taken in the past, and I would propose we go down either on a weeknight evening and would miss the next day of school, or we would go down, if approved, on a Sunday afternoon and miss the following Monday, returning that evening. What we're going to do is to visit the New York Stock Exchange. We would spend our morning at Vandermeulen brokerage firm, which is a stock specialist. And in the past, they have entertained us in their main office, which coincidentally overlooks Ground Zero. And they take the students through what their job entails. So it comes at the end of the stock market unit. They then take us, after we have an introductory session at Vandermeulen, they take us over to the members gallery of the New York Stock Exchange. Again, since 9/11, it's a very long line to wait in the visitors gallery, and it's also like 3 or 4 stories up. It's behind bulletproof glass, whereas the members gallery is about its ceiling height, open air, and 2 or 3 of the brokerage come over with us and spend as much time as the students want asking questions and answering their questions, informing them about what we see going on. It's always a matter of chance as to whether it's going to be a busy day. If a Federal Reserve announcement has just come the day before, we were down 1 year. It was the election of 2000. It was about a week after the election, so it was a little hectic that day as well. So depending upon what's going on at that particular time, we will generate the, you know, corresponding questions. We will go from there to possibly, in the past, we've taken a tour of Ground Zero and the site where that is. I'm not sure what status that's in right now. I know they're still wrestling with plans for the memorial as well as the rebuilding of the Twin Towers. And we may hit 1 or 2 other sites in the area before we again drive north to be home in the evening. So again, we would leave after school on a weekday and miss, say, a Friday and be home that evening. Or, depending upon the contact I have with the broker there, Artie Prant, we may leave on Sunday afternoon and just miss school on Monday and come back Monday evening. So that would be a one-day trip as well, but it would be an overnight trip. The cost, again, on this one is borne by the students. In the past, I have found parents of students in the class to volunteer to drive us down, and the students divide the cost of the gasoline tolls as well as hotel accommodations for the chaperones. So that's how that one has been funded.
Okay.
Any questions on that one?
Sure. Trish?
I don't know whether I should say this at the end in terms of liability and all that, particularly when it's not a school, when it's a parent driving. Do we do all of that later?
Well, I was just going to ask the same question, is how do you, have you arranged in the past as far as liability coverage with parents driving as opposed to using a bus from a bus company?
Students have signed, have had their parents sign a permission form, but I don't think there's been anything in the past about liability. I don't think that issue has come up before.
I think we are going to have to take a little closer look at that.
Okay.
Particularly to, I think we'll have to have some kind of check to find out the level of liability they have on their vehicle at that point in time.
Okay.
So you and I can talk about that.
Sure. So it would be important to find out who those people are up front.
Exactly.
And talk.
So that they can, we can talk with them and they can arrange the coverage that's necessary.
Okay. As this is the first of the overnight trips, I would also point out that the way this one has worked in the past is we have the students bring in their overnight luggage, leave it with Mr. Tinkham, and he conducts a thorough search of it, and then we load it immediately from his office into the vans that are going down. The third and final trip is a four-day trip for the AP government class. These are 15 seniors, and this is a trip to Washington, D.C. As proposed, we would leave immediately after school on Wednesday, March 15th. In the past 2 years that we've taken this trip, we have found Southwest Air out of Manchester to be the most affordable. So again, we've had parents volunteer to drive us down to the airport. Some of the chaperones, of course, are members of the staff. This year, I expect it to be the same, members of the Social Studies Department. And so we divvy up the students and drive down to Manchester. We fly down there that evening. Not much going on in terms of the field trip that night. The following morning, Thursday, we have in the past spent pretty much the entire day in the legislative branch. We have been graciously welcomed by Tom Allen into his office for about an hour each of the past 2 years, taking any and all questions on any subjects of interest to the students. And then his staff has taken us on a tour of the Capitol. In the afternoon the past 2 years, we've met and talked with both Senators Collins and Snow. Logistically, it worked out very well that they were located in the same office building, so we would meet them over there and get a kind of a feel for their job. This trip, again, if approved, would come at the time of the year in mid-March when there is, it's actually a day called Votorama, when they are voting on countless bills. So it just gives the students an idea of how hectic their lives are, and also a real sobering lesson on how hastily some of this legislation is passed, which is a true lesson and one I think that our officials need to answer more to, but that's another subject. The following day, again, we try to take advantage of the weekdays when the government offices are open, and we will, again, last year we were able to visit a tour of the White House. We also were able to, through the generous intercession of one of our parents, of last year's students, get into the Supreme Court and actually went into the chambers of Justice Breyer and talked with two of his interns for about an hour. So whether we can repeat that one, I'm not sure, but we will visit the court. The end of the day, again, because they're pretty intense days, as you can imagine. We might do something a little more, you know, to let the kids be kids and go to a museum, go on a tour of the mall at night. Saturday, the past 2 years, we have gone to the Holocaust Museum, and we are currently in the process of negotiating with the colleague of the a current student's father, who is a lobbyist. So we're trying to meet with them to plug in. That's like one missing piece. We have done judicial, legislative, and executive branch. It would be wonderful if we could meet up with some of the lobbyists to find out what their job is like in passing law. So those are the 3 days, and we would return very early on Sunday morning, flying out. Again, we fly from Manchester to BWI, that's the Baltimore airport, again, derived because of the price, the affordability of it, and then take a shuttle service from BWI, which is about an hour, use the same one both years, and it's been a success. And would we return just opposite that to have a shuttle pick us up in the morning, take us back to BWI, fly back to Manchester, and probably be back here to Cape Elizabeth in the early afternoon. Again, this one is funded entirely by the students. In the past 2 years, I've tried to approach each student individually to ascertain whether this has become, if this is a burden, because the cost is about, at least last year, was on the order of $500, $550 per student. It hasn't been an issue, but I again will meet with the students, the 15 ones individually, to find out if it is, as I will with the previous two classes. And if so, then we will work on some sort of fundraising or try to find out if any scholarship money is available. So those are the three proposed trips with some kind of sketchy details as to what we'll be doing.
When were you planning the New York Stock Exchange trip?
That one would be in the middle of February, maybe early March.
If there are no further questions?
The only thing that, if I may comment, is first of all, I'd like to congratulate you. These are well-planned field trips and sound like excellent opportunities for your students. And so I don't want to put any kind of damper on it, but I do think we need to take a look at the liability issues on each of those. And so I think it's the type of thing where I'm hoping the board tonight, if they choose to, would at least approve in principle the trips themselves, and then we will work, Pauline and I will work with you as far as the liability issues and how those can be resolved.
Yeah, great. Thank you.
Okay. And I think that's all we have on this trip. So thank you for coming.
Thank you.
Taking the time to share with us. David, you're the other trip, and at this point we heard from you at our last meeting regarding your particular trip, and it's up as unfinished business for a vote.
I think at this point in time, David and I talked briefly just beforehand. David has sent along to me the insurance papers, which are in good order. We are still in the process of trying to resolve the issue, which I think is pretty well resolved, that once you vote in favor of allowing the trip to happen, you do have a liability responsibility to the trip. And so what we will need to do on each of these trips individually, even the one which I think the Italian one is over a school vacation, each of those we need to check as far as what our overriding liability is along the insurance papers, so that now that I have your insurance papers, those will be sent along to Maine Municipal Association, am I correct, Pauline? So that they can take a look at those and then see what our insurance will cover above and beyond that. So again, I think it's an approval in principle, but it's still a final approval once we have that information finalized. The other two trips, I do not have at this point their insurance papers. And so those I would ask that you table again tonight until we have those in place.
Great.
All right. Does anyone have any specific questions for David? And we need a motion later for tabling this item. Okay.
And David, I thank you for getting those papers as quickly as you could. I appreciate it.
Thank you for being patient with me.
That's all right.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Is there one more trip?
We have one more, which is a natural helper training.
That's right.
Which is in your packet. It's from Andrea Kerr, and I don't think she's here tonight. It looks like Jeff, though, is prepared to speak to it. So.
And this is also an annual trip. We have, for board members who are not familiar with the group, the Natural Helpers has been in existence for a number of years. It's a group of students who are selected by other students in the high school as people who are good listeners, who can channel to adults in the building if there are kids that other students are aware of who may be having some difficulties of a personal nature, a substance abuse nature, or whatever nature. It's sort of an avenue of communication, and it does involve some training. The training is an annual thing that's happened each of the last several years, certainly since I've been here. It's actually picked up, the cost of the training is, well, the training is provided by day one under a contract, the cost of which has traditionally at least come from a Title IV grant. Is that what it is now, Tom? Title IVA. The federal government keeps changing its numbering, and the training is an overnight training. It's a two-day, and it is in Sanford, Maine. But it is a training where representatives from all different schools across the region come together. I apologize, I didn't bring the dates with me, but it is those dates are this fall, and I wanted to get the approval out if we could.
The dates are November 8th, 9th, and 10th.
Thank you. Sorry.
Any further questions for Jeff? Thank you.
Thanks.
Moving along in the agenda, we'll go to the school report, and we welcome Steve Connolly to speak to us about the middle school. Thanks.
Good evening. Did you happen to notice that the two guys that spoke earlier from the middle school were dressed alike? No plan on our parts. I looked down, they got the red polos, the khakis, and the sandals. I wore the khakis today. I'm not up for the sandals. But anyways, Alan and I have been talking extensively, as I also have been with Tom Eismeyer and Jeff Shedd, about the data work that we're doing at the middle school. You'll see as I go through this that a lot of the data that's driving our conversations right now is about the MEAs, but I don't want you to get the feeling that that's the way that I think the data should be driven. The difficulty that I have with trying to generate the idea about a data literate community is that as far as information goes that I can put my hands on for tangible information right now, the MEA seems to be the hardcore piece that we've had for years. We've had the DRPs. It's a reading piece that's happened at the school. We used to have the CATs. We've had other components, but there hasn't been anything that has had the lifespan and the comparability to state scores and so forth. So we're currently using that information. We're going to be building our data loops as we go through our assessment trainings. So I'm just going to walk you through some of the information, give you the flavor for the kinds of things we've been doing at the middle school for our staff meetings, team meetings, and could be evaluation and supervision meetings as well. First off, you'll see as you turn over the page, if you look where it says summary of scores, you'll see that what we were doing was taking our writing, reading, math, and science and technology scores. We were comparing Cape Elizabeth scores to the state scores, and we were looking for trends in that. Now, there are three levels when we're doing our data work. One is, what's the data that you have at hand? The second piece is, and this is the part that a lot of groups miss when they're doing the data work, is what questions does this generate for you? What questions do you have? Because the data itself doesn't tell you anything. It's you got to look at that and say, so what do I think is going on here? What trends do I see? What questions will I generate? And then from those questions, then you have actions that you take, and then you start the loop over again. So that's where we've been going. So the next, where it says summary of scores, and then you see average performance scores for the next four pages, we did two things at a staff meeting. Number one is we look first of all at the overall scores, comparing our writing, reading, math, science, and technology to that of just the state scores. Later on, we'll look at it compared to other districts that we feel are comparable to Cape Elizabeth. And what we noted in each one of those were the bands and the differences between, let's say, the writing score for the state might have been a 538, and the writing score for our school in eighth graders was 541. And then that led us to some questions. So if you turn over to the next page, you see the writing scores. I gave them the three-year trends, and by the images here, you can see, for instance, that the ELA writing is going down 1 point steadily over the last 3 years, while the state scores have risen just about the same rate in the other direction. And if we extrapolate that data out a little bit, we'd see that in two more years, we'd be at state level in the writing scores. So we have a lot of questions about that. Why is this occurring? And what are we going to do about it? What kinds of things are we trying? One of the things that this has really done a good job with us on is figuring out two things, writing across the content areas, how are we doing that? And another one is teachers getting into other people's classrooms to provide them feedback on the kinds of activities that are going on. As I talk with staff, they haven't had the opportunity as of late to get in the last few years to get into other classrooms because they've been so busy with assessments and all kinds of things. So that as we discuss it, and I'm saying to them, so this is what you do, and someone else says, oh, I didn't realize that. So it's been a while since they've had the opportunity to chat, and we're beginning to open those doors back up. So then we went on. I had four projectors set up in a staff meeting, for instance. There were the math scores on one, reading scores on another, the writing scores on another, and finally the science and tech. And what staff were doing was they were picking a particular data set that they wanted to have some input on at that staff meeting. Now, some people naturally were able to get to more than one data set, and of course we'll be doing more work with that. But after those pages, you see a sheet that says staff-generated data questions. So during that September staff meetings, the questions that were turned into me, I broke out into the content areas, science, writing, math, and reading, and then also the general questions. When John Casey and I went down through these, what we were able to see is what kinds of questions are people able to generate about data? Do we have a staff that's ready to move on from generating questions, or do we need to take more time in working on the development of the questions themselves? Because the questions have to lead you to an action that is measurable. If it's not leading you to an action that's measurable, what's the question going to lead you to? So, for instance, in here, one of the questions that somebody might have asked is, what are we doing right, or what about foreign language? And so those kinds of questions are too general. They're not specific enough to lead us toward another action and some kind of decisions and data collection, further data collection. So, but you see that there are some questions in here, like people were curious about the MEA tests. Was it a match for our curriculum? So I'd love to lay out the content standards and the performance indicators of the questions from the release items that we gathered on what was asked about of students, and then match that up with a matrix of, or an overlay of, what are the content standards that are hit in the different grade levels, and what are the concepts or generalizations that are hit, and see if there's a pretty good correlation to that. I would think in some subject areas there are, and I would think in some others I'm finding out that there may not be such a good correlation. So that leads us to further work. Also on the next page of the reading of the questions, you see down in the reading section, it says, what do the categories mean? For instance, there was a category called the process of reading. And what I realized from that is, we have some folks who aren't used to the titles that are used and what that subgroup is going to lead to. So John and I started off by doing some work from square one with the MEAs, for instance. What are the data, what are the range bands? What is a does not meet the standard? What is a partially meets, a meets? What's an exceed? And Trish, you were at the MSPA and I shared that same data work with folks. Okay, if you turn the page there, well, I'll see, are there any questions yet? Any questions yet? Feel free to jump in any time. The next page, it says, Giving Data Its Own Assessment by Susan Ticheni and Linda Plattner. This particular article came out of a May 2005 NEA newspaper, and it was a very helpful article because it gets at a few key points. One, the state or federal level assessments should not be the benchmark of your data work. Now I'm saying that as I'm telling you that right now it's the piece that we're able to use in a consistent manner, but we're going to develop more over time. Another thing that it will say in here is that anything that you value you should be able to measure to see its effectiveness. And I included some more quotes that I pulled from the article in the last just after the article. So the question that I pose to staff and our team leaders in looking at this article is, what data should we be using to create a mosaic of any student's learning and skills? Number one, easy, everybody said MEAs. Number two, DRPs. Number three, local assessment system, our local assessment pieces. Number four, we were all kind of stuck on that one. So that's where we're starting to build the conversation. And from the article, it said, the data is only useful when it quickly helps educators identify and attend to teaching in areas of student need. So I'm not asking by saying data literate staff that they become masters of statistics. What I'm saying is, it's John's job and my job to be able to figure out how to put the data in a very useful graphic form that can generate, that people can then take that information and generate the questions. And some of those questions that they ask may lead them back to our pool of information, our pool of data, to see if there's some breakout or disaggregation that they can do in there. The challenge is to couple data immediately with more effective strategies and help teachers to learn how to approach their work differently. It's another key point of the article. Annual data at best provides a second check on school level data. And I think before I've talked about how I see the MEAs being more like a physical and a health check. I think Trish was there for that conversation. We'll create time for collegial analysis of data from several sources. Data should guide the conversation by spotlighting areas in need of improved instructional methods and strategies. And the challenge is to give teachers practical information that is easily understood and immediately useful. So the work that we're doing with them, we're not saying 4 years down the road we want to see some of these things to fruition. We're saying, what are the immediate impacts that we're going to have? What are some of the mid-range and what are some long-range goals that we're going to have? So we're working on establishing all three. Now, on that same team leader agenda from September 22nd, it cites the four questions that Alan, Claire, and I, Tom, and Jeff have been hearing in our attendance of some dine and discuss evenings with the CBEA, which is actually by Dufour and Dufour. You can see the four questions there. What is it we want all students to learn? How we know when each student has mastered that essential learning? How we respond when students experience initial difficulty? And what will we do to deepen the learning for students who have already mastered the essential learning and skills? So all of the work that we do in data will be around getting at these four questions, particularly what is it we want all students to know and how we know when they know it. Okay, if you flip over to the page that says data, a team leader meeting from September 29th, you see on there a representation about some more data that was pulled from the MEA in the writing. Notice that there are four levels that you could score in the MEAs. An exceeds, down at the bottom you see the letter E, a meets, a partially meets, and a does not meet the standard. If the page that I'm looking at looks like this, just in case, because I did not number these. Math deficiency. Okay. On the side, you see the percentage of student where the students fell in these. 71% of the females in grade 8 last year met the standard in writing. As a matter of fact, the overall average for students was for the females was 544. The overall average for the males was 538. And you see that only 40% of the males met that performance. So you can already, I bet you the wheels are turning already. You're probably already asking yourselves some questions. Now on, and we'll get to the kinds of ways that we use this because it's further on in the packet. The next page is a roadmap that John and I created for the staff for the year so that they have some guiding matrix about what we're going to be expecting from them. We're working on going from a congenial staff to a collegial staff, being able to have critical friends, work in professional learning communities, and to provide critical feedback. And we're going to be doing visits to each other's classrooms, and we're going to be looking at professional learning community protocols. I'm going to move right along to the next page because I know my time is waning. You see, this is the work that we're doing right now. As of October 6th, John and I asked the team leaders to begin conversations with people about the data that we've given them on the subsequent page that says, what does this lead you to think about writing in your classroom? What about writing on your team or grade level? What about across your content area? What about at the district level? And what about at the out-of-district level? And we've again made the point that the idea is that we need to be reflective about what we think the implications of the data might be, not to just jump to actions. And the answer is not a program. The answer is behavioral changes. So you can see at the bottom of the October 16 leaders meeting, you can see the same data chart about the exceeds, meets, partially meets, and does not meet the standard. And then the second level that I gave them of that was, if you turn to the last page in your packet, it says that what I did was I took the scores and I looked at, okay, out of the girls, the females that that met the standard, how many of those kids, if they'd gotten one or two more points or questions right on the MEA, would have gone from just missing exceeding the standard into the exceeding the standard range? And the answer is 50%. 50% of the girls finished between 550 and 560. And the exceeds the standard is 561. The boys, the males in that group, you can see were 25% between the 550 to the 560 range. So there again, what kinds of questions does this lead us to create? And from that, what actions, what steps are we going to take, and how are we going to measure those steps? So this is all September to October right now, and we'll keep you up to date as we move along. Sorry for the crash course on that. What questions do you have?
Trish?
Trish, you've been in almost all of this. How can you have a question from the MSBA?
Well, because it takes me two times to hear it before.
Oh, I see, I see.
I think it's great that this is happening and the discussion's happening and the questions are coming on. I'm curious to know, in the conversation, how do the local assessments and the data accumulated through those tie into this analysis? We're focusing on the MEA, but I know that those were useful exercises and the teachers really got to talking. And does it offer any answers? Does it generate more questions? Are we doing something comparative when we're looking at our curriculum?
Great question, thanks for mentioning that. Right now what we're doing with the local assessments, the last two years were development of local assessments. Strictly development, piloting, trying them out. This year we're at a middle phase, which is examining we're reviewing those and saying, which ones do we have just the way we want that are actually embedded into the curriculum and can tell us other information? Because I want this stuff just to tell us our once a year annual physical. Are we as healthy as we think we are? So those are the pieces that will answer, that will provide the dailiness or the monthliness for our information. We also have some assessments that we're saying those are pretty good, but they're not quite yet where we want to see them. And then of course the last range is there are some that every school in the state has probably done just to be the good soldier. All right, I've got to figure out something that meets this. I don't have enough assessments. I don't have all the data pieces I'm supposed to. And so then the next thing has come along. We want to weed out those kinds of assessments that actually don't tell us a darn thing that we can use, that once you do that, gets buried in a drawer somewhere. So we want to get rid of those, or actually leave them buried in a drawer, and we want to create assessments, and Alan has recommended the Northwest Educational Assessments for us to look at. I'm very intrigued by their website, so I think we may be onto something that can help us not to reinvent the wheel, waste a lot of time, but can actually provide us good information to cross-pollinate this step.
Thank you.
If I could just say a word.
Yeah.
I'd like to thank Steve. I gave him the impossible task of 15 to 20 minutes as an overview for this. As you can already tell, there's a lot of information here. But I've watched Steve and his staff working on this, and I'm very pleased because I think in the last few years, we all talk about data and how to use it. And I think for the first time, I'm beginning to see some real serious work around what the data tells us. The MEA is what we're using now, but as you asked, we'll also be looking at the local assessments. We'll be looking at other assessments that we can use also. But I think we're on the right track here as far as looking at it from the perspective of what is the data telling us around gender, and also around that piece that Steve mentioned where state scores tend to be going up, and in some cases, our scores tend to be dropping a little, and do we want to meet in the middle? I don't think so. And so some important questions are coming out of this, and that will generate some important answers. Thank you, Steve.
I'm sorry, I actually have a question, two. One for you, Steve, and one for you. Has there been any sort of immediate response in terms of curriculum in any of these areas, or are we still in the analysis stage?
Well, first off, one of the pieces that I haven't spent a lot of time on, because I'm talking about where our focus is taking us, is along the literacy approach. But for instance, the mathematics exceptional scores, 544 for the average, numerous students exceeding and meeting the standards. Excellent, excellent scores. So we're very pleased about that. And we're trying to relate that. Now, how can there not be any gender difference between those same kids in math and have a substantial one in writing? So we're trying to look at our other pieces to try to draw some kind of correlation. Am I answering your question?
Has anything been changed?
Changed curriculum-wise already?
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you for refocusing.
This is a long process that you're going to have to do in terms of coming to terms with the data and making it meaningful.
Yes.
Are you holding off on changing things, or have you?
No. There's a very easy thing that I see. The more you write, and the more feedback you get, the better writer you're going to be. The more jump shots you take, the likely, and you've got good someone coaching you, the better jump shooter you're going to be. So I've been looking at the number of minutes that kids had for language arts, for instance, in Pond Cove, and I'm seeing a substantial drop in that because they might have, for instance, two sections of language arts in a day up through fourth grade, and then they get to the fifth grade on and they have one section. Well, that's cutting your minutes in half. So how is it that we're doing a couple of things? One is looking for writing across the content area, meaningful writing, and I'm talking with everybody about there is nothing wrong with holding in a science class that you've just given a major writing assignment. There's nothing wrong with holding a writing conference, and there's no reason that writing that's substantial can't receive a grade here in writing and a grade here in the language arts, and that they can't be worked on at the same time. Two different sets of teachers. So we're trying to build the idea of interdisciplinary work, of the collegialness of that, and we're also trying to figure out ways to give a minute-by-minute inoculation. How can we add time to our writing and reading content? That's the biggest impetus right now.
And Alan, my question for you is, this
Northwest Education Assessment.
When will we as a board be able to see this before? My concern is that a lot of time is being put into it at the school, the teacher staff level, but I haven't seen anything, and I'd be very curious to kind of get a peek at it.
Right now, Rebecca, we're in the early stages. As we have taken a look at it, we're looking at it specifically for the ninth graders at the high school. Just to do a test run from it. We have the people coming in from NWEA to do presentations for our administrative staff. As a matter of fact, I think we're going to Yarmouth for some of that presentation, and then they'll be coming in to work with teachers. Those pieces you will be invited to attend if you would like. NWEA offers some very interesting results, very quick results, unlike the MEA, which we wait for months for. And also offer some assistance as far as looking at what are next steps in the process. So that as we do more work around it, we will be inviting board members in as well, so you can get a chance to look at it. What I'm finding right now is a majority of the school systems here in Cumberland County, we've all talked about it as superintendents, and a majority of us are now working our way into adopting it, so it become pretty standard work in Cumberland County area.
I decided to flip a few things around, and I've got to go back up to the top of the agenda here. At this moment, we're going to take comments from the public on non-agenda items. I don't see anyone rushing the podium, and we'll move on to recognition.
And recognition for AP Scholars and National Merit Scholarship, I had asked Jeff if he would speak to those, please.
I think you have in your school board packets actually the names, so I'm not going to bother to read all of the text that goes along with the names, but I wanted to at least highlight the names of the students because they're certainly well worth mentioning. And I'm going to start with the AP Scholars. These are students who have achieved a benchmark average score on three or more exams, depending on what their particular distinction is. And we have, starting at the bottom of your list that you have here, 15 students. These are 15 students from last year, obviously, and from the last 2 years, actually, who qualified for the AP Scholar Award by completing three or more AP exams with grades of three or higher. And just so you're aware, a grade of three on the AP exam is considered a passing grade, and depending on the college that a student gets to, either you can actually, in some places, you can get credit for it, in some cases get advanced standing for it, but there are differences from college to college. But in any event, a score of three is a fine result on the AP exams. And so the students are, well, first of all, I guess I would mention the graduate student, the seniors who have already graduated from last year's graduating class: Chase Dittrich, Zach Donahue, Reed Hansen, Jack Malcolm, Ben McKinney, Aaron Maloney, Aaron Samenfeld-Specht, Spencer Scott, and Dustin Turn. Those were members of the class of 2005 who attained that distinction. The present juniors, who have attained that distinction based on grades of three or higher and three or more AP exams, are Jess Danielson, Claire Egan, Coleman Hatton, Sam Labosco, Grace Needleman, and Zach Rio. So those are absolutely deserving of some strong mention and commendation because it's a result of a lot of work. AP Scholar with Honor Awards for scoring an average grade of at least 3.25 on four or more exams. The seniors, the graduates, Christine Babick, Corinne Earnshaw, Allie Melsack, Jake Metzger, Elizabeth Michaud, and Beth Roy, and there are actually two current juniors who are on that list as well, one of whom some board members have come to know in some other contexts, and that is Mary Cox and Emma Hansen. AP Scholar with Distinction Award, earning a grade of at least 3.5 on five or more exams. These are all recent graduates of the high school: Caitlin Becker, Emma Bond, Christy Katsos, Brad McClavick, Anna Moyer, Kaylee Skopinski, and Boris Babson. And there's one student who was recognized as a national AP Scholar with an average grade of four or higher on a five-point scale on eight or more of these exams. Now, eight or more AP exams, considering that you really don't get an opportunity to take them, with the exception of statistics, until junior year, is quite a challenge for any student to take on. And Boris Babson certainly is quite a student, and he's moved along. He graced our halls, but he did an outstanding job and absolutely earned the distinction of National AP Scholar for that outstanding achievement. So certainly our congratulations to all of those students for their outstanding accomplishment and work effort. Advanced placement is, I think it's a really valuable program. It's the only program nationwide in which there is sort of a national standard about how kids are doing, and it's a quality standard. The exams are quality standards that measures what kids know and what can they do on some really challenging exam questions and essay questions and other kinds of questions. So it's absolutely outstanding. The next group are students who are commended students or semifinalists in the National Merit Competition, which is a nationwide competition based on the results of the PSAT tests that students at the high school take both as sophomores and juniors. And actually, it's well timed that we're making this sort of announcement today because our sophomores and juniors tomorrow are taking PSATs in the morning. Commended students, and the text here indicates that there's over a million kids who participate in the PSATs on an annual basis. Less than 1% of the nation's high school seniors are ultimately named semifinalists, and only slightly more than that are named commended students. So commended students, we're all current seniors. Dana Riker, Connor Hankinson, actually, who you saw earlier, who's been a school board representative this year and last year as well, Jeremy Falk, and Jess Danielson. And semifinalists in the competition and still sort of in the running for possible consideration for scholarships are Zach Rio and Cy Rio, who are twin brothers, by the way, and Carlin Geyer. So congratulations to all those students. It's an outstanding accomplishment for that as well.
Thank you. We also have item number C, which is School Bus Driver Appreciation Day, which is next Friday, October 21st.
And I thought it would be important just to recognize the bus drivers, and I would like to take a minute. I'm not going to read the entire proclamation, but just to point out some of the things that they talk about are the responsibilities of a bus driver. I think all too often it's easy to take them for granted. And so it talks about school bus drivers operate a vehicle responsible for carrying the children of Maine to and from school. The duties of the school bus driver are integral to the daily process of educating students. School bus drivers often perform their duties in the midst of adverse conditions, while exercising caution and following the laws of the road to maximize the safety of their passengers. School bus drivers act as mentors and teachers, serving as upstanding examples of safety, courtesy, discipline, and effective communication as they perform their duties each day. I think statistically, there are more than 2,000 school bus drivers who travel in excess of 32 million miles, carrying more than 170,000 students in Maine. And the school bus driver has a unique and vital position in the lives of Maine children and an important representative of the educational system with the responsibilities to school boards, administrators, parents, and students. And so, as Elaine noted at the beginning, on October 21st, 2005, it is School Bus Driver Appreciation Day. And I wanted to make that public so people would realize some of the work the school bus drivers do.
Okay. Thank you. I imagine, I know some neighborhoods will bake and greet their school bus drivers. And so hopefully they'll note that day and remember them. So. The superintendent's report.
Yes, I have a couple of things to report on. The first one on the list is AYP-MEA. We in education love those little acronyms. But AYP is basically adequate yearly progress. MEA, as you heard Steve say, is the main educational assessment. As you have seen in the paper and received emails from me, et cetera, you know that one of our schools, Cape Elizabeth High School, this year is on the AYP list. But I think it is important. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this evening. We'll spend more time later. I think it's important for you to understand the distinction of that AYP process. MEAs were adopted, I think, 14 years ago, if I'm not mistaken. It seems like it's been forever, maybe a little shorter than that. The original plan of the MEA was to measure the acquisition of the main learning results, to look at the benchmarks, to look at the performance indicators, and see how well we're doing, both individually by student and also by grade level and throughout the system and throughout the state. A few years ago, NCLB, No Child Left Behind legislation passed in Washington. At that point in time, there became another layer of issue with the MEA. Each state had to select some kind of assessment that they could use that they could report to the federal government to show the progress that is being made in a school system. With that, what they looked at were several what they call subgroups. So that what they would look at is the total scores, but also look at some certain subgroups within the school systems. One of those subgroups, or sub areas, is participation. It is expected that when a school is doing MEAs, that at least 95% of the students participate in the MEAs. If they don't participate, if we don't have a 95%, then we are cited as an AYP school system. It has led to some very interesting processes throughout the state, including principals and even sometimes superintendents going from door to door to pick up students and bring them to school. It has provided some interesting reward systems, et cetera. Perhaps some that we don't particularly like, but we also know that if we don't meet that 95% requirement, then we will be an AYP school. Other subgroups it talks about is ethnicity. And in order to be counted by your ethnic groups, that group must be at least have 10 members or more. And so here in Cape Elizabeth, we do not have enough students at each level to be judged by the ethnic backgrounds of our students. It also talks about economic disadvantage. This year, they went back to using free and reduced lunch. Last year, they used the information about whether they had computers and internet access in their homes. That was decided that was an inappropriate way to determine disadvantaged students, so they used free and reduced lunch. Again, free and reduced economically disadvantaged for Cape Elizabeth is not a large enough segment in order to use that as a subgroup. Another area that they look at is identified disabilities. And that is basically those students who have been identified with a learning or several learning disabilities. We do have large enough subgroups here in Cape Elizabeth so that they can be judged by that. If you've read the newspaper articles and my comments in the newspapers, I've been very careful to say over and over again that although Cape Elizabeth High School's grade 11 performed very well as an entire group, the AYP designation of identified disability pointed out that we didn't meet the same cutoff as was expected across the state, and that cutoff for identified disability grows yearly. What concerns me greatly is that the first year this was done, we were told that we were not to identify to the news media or to the public what these subgroups were. Now that immediate identification comes out in the newspapers because of the initial report that comes from the DOE. My concern is that identifiable disabilities often is a fairly small group, enough to be counted, but not a large group. And one of my biggest fears has always been its backlash. As far as this group is concerned. We are very clear that they did not meet the standard that had been set this year, which was 50% or more, reaching exceeds or meets the standard. We are looking at that very carefully. But I want to be really clear that in all three schools, grades 4, 8, and 11, we met and exceeded state averages across the board. At the identified disability stage, at grade 4 and grade 8, we met the standard. We met it. We were right on the borderline, but we met that standard. So it is forcing us to take a look at what we might be able to do to assist in improving those. But I think it is always very important, and one of the things that I've tried to downplay completely is that AYP status, based on the information that is there right now, is a misnomer for some people, because there are some people who look at that and think, oh my goodness, we had a high school that last year was a blue ribbon high school, the only one in the state, and this year we're AYP. Boy, they have gone downhill fast. That's not the message, and I want to be very clear that that's not the message. Our scores at grade 11, again, for the entire population, were very good. And one of the things we have to consider, and I think one of the things Jeff and I have both talked about, as we move from MEA to SAT, MEA becomes a question of attitudes and perceptions of students around that test. As they reach their junior year, they are very much aware there are certain tests that count a great deal, SAT being one of those. MEA, for what we know right now, does not count individually for them when they're going off to college. So I think perhaps the SAT may, and I stress may, give us a better picture of how our students are performing at the 11th grade level. But I'm pleased that you changed the agenda a little, because I'm pleased that Steve spoke before I did, because I think Steve also made a very clear message that we do need to take a very close look at the MEA scores and what they tell us, but they are not the end all that some people think they are. You've seen me quoted several times as saying MEA is a snapshot. It is done in a very specific time frame, on very specific days, and is not something that you can use to look at an entire year of what is happening. So it goes back to your question, Trish. about the local assessment system. It goes back to the NWEA and how we might use that differently, how we use the DRA, how we use many different assessments that we do, and how we look at those system-wide and how we are succeeding. That, in a nutshell, is my report at this point on AYP and MEA. I will be looking at, as we move along this year, to answer some of the questions, particularly, I think, Rebecca's question about how is the information we're gathering on the MEA affecting how we present curriculum and what type of instruction is occurring in the classrooms. And that will be information that we'll be coming back with as the year progresses, as we continue to look at information around all of the different scores and data that we have. You just listened to Jeff talk about some extremely high-performing students. Probably, in most cases, a larger number than you would find in most high schools in the state. Not all high schools, but most. And so that is another piece that we need to look at as we move ahead and gather the data and look at the data very carefully.
Al, you reminded me of a question I had earlier for Jeff, which was, correct me if I'm wrong, because there's so much coming at us, but last year I was under the impression that the 11th grade MEA was going to be required for graduation. That you were, doesn't anybody else on the board remember that? That they would be allowed to graduate, but there would be, but without the, it wasn't going to be accredited graduation. We spent a lot of time talking about this. We were really concerned as a board about how that, because we knew the kids weren't taking the MEA seriously, and what was going to happen to all of these kids who took it and didn't perform as well.
I think I know what you're talking about, and so I'll look for some head nods to see if I'm getting them, to see if I'm on the right wavelength. It wasn't the MEA itself that was ever required for graduation, but what the state had said is that it was, as of last year, it was last year's ninth graders, this year's 10th graders, who, if the state hadn't postponed things for the second year in a row, they would have had to demonstrate their knowledge and skills on the local assessment system, Rebecca, that we created. And the state is now sort of in a hiatus for that. This is the process where they're now going through, and they're going to send out teams to all the schools across the state looking at where they are with the development of the local assessment system. But the MEA itself was never required to be. Schools had to, as they develop the local assessment system, schools were required to indicate how, if at all, the MEA would count in their local assessment system, but it wasn't a requirement itself. But I think that's what you're getting at.
Is that still a possibility going down the road? You say it's been tabled.
It's absolutely a possibility. I think we're in a state of really not knowing what the state is going to do at this point. The last conversation there was around not so much not allowing kids to graduate, but around the possibility of differentiated diplomas, learning results diplomas or diplomas with certain endorsements in certain subject areas. But the Department of Education has not spelled that out in any way. They have really sort of put aside trying to spell that out until they gather the information to try to figure out what all the problems were that they were hearing about from Cape Elizabeth and elsewhere about the system of assessments and requirements that they had come up with.
That's this year's 10th graders that it would happen potentially.
I think it's off the table for this year's 10th graders. The earliest group that it would apply for would be this year's 8th graders. We would have the option if we wanted to make it apply for this year's 9th graders, but quite frankly, we don't know what it is yet. I think the earliest that the local assessment system would count towards graduation, either the decision whether you graduate at all or the decision what kind of diploma you would get, wouldn't kick in until this year's 8th graders at the earliest. Okay. Yeah.
And the second report?
Second.
I did put into your packets the 2005 College Bound Seniors information. One thing I want to stress here is tonight I am really focusing in on the high school, mainly because of the AYP, but I also want to remind you that a majority of these high school students who are juniors and seniors, are products of Pond Cove Elementary School and are products of Cape Elizabeth Middle School. And so what we need to look at is what has happened to them over an extended period of time. So what we, when we look at 11th graders, and by the time we get the MEAs back, they are now our 12th graders, our graduating seniors, we look at it from the perspective of what has happened as a system for them. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this other than to again report, again looking at data, that it talks about in the SAT reasoning test on verbal, mean, and middle of the 50th percent range, it shows that, Cape Elizabeth High School had a mean score of 571, as compared to the main state mean score of 509 and the national score of 508. So if you look at that, you can see how well our students at Cape Elizabeth are performing. And if you are looking at it, this is on page one, looking across the range, it has gone from 561, 566, right across to 571. So it continues to grow, an important piece that you need to consider. The math mean scores, you heard Steve mention middle school math. Math mean score last year for this current senior class was 593. The mean score for the state was 505, and the nation was 520. So we're scoring 88 points above what is the mean score for the state. So I think it's, you know, extremely important to keep that always in perspective. Now, are all students getting this success rate? No. Do we need to do some more work? Yes. I think you heard me say when you were interviewing me back a few months ago, one of the things I said is that no matter where we are, we always look to improve. And so I think this is a type of data that helps us do this, and it's the type of data we will continue to use to take a look at our students. I should also mention there is a college admissions report in here, which again, if you looked at college admission reports across the state, again, you would see some uniqueness for Cape Elizabeth and a few others, that of the 124 graduating members of the class of 2005, 111, or 89.5%, pursued post-secondary education, a high percentage. Of those students, 98% attended four-year colleges, and the majority will be attending private colleges and universities, 71%, and others will be attending schools out of state, 87%. So I think it's really important. Again, it's hard when you don't have comparison of districts around you and outside to recognize the great successes that we do see here in Cape Elizabeth for a majority of our students. Do we always look to be better? Of course we do. But I think it's important to have some of this data just to keep a perspective on where we are at this point in time.
Okay. And I'd like to take this opportunity to offer you to speak regarding your trip and Project Blueprint.
Sure. I'll just take a few minutes, but Project Blueprint, which some of you may have heard of and some of you may not have heard of, but approximately 4 years ago, several superintendents who were meeting, I believe, meeting in the Portland area, as a matter of fact, began to talk about school systems that are high-performing school systems. And what is there about those school systems that makes them high-performing school systems? So what they did is form a consortium, which is now called Project Blueprint. There are six school systems across the country who participate in this. One is Whitefish Bay, Wisconsin. Another is Wayland, Massachusetts. Clayton, Missouri. Kintnersville, Pennsylvania, which is Palisades School District. Edina Public Schools in Edina, Minnesota, and Cape Elizabeth, Maine. I had the opportunity a few weeks ago, along with Sarah Simmons, to go to a Project Blueprint meeting in Minneapolis, or Edina. It was an amazing, amazing opportunity for me personally, because I was in amongst superintendents, principals, and curriculum directors of these very high-performing schools with us. And we had a lot of discussions around what makes the difference. There were several things we looked at. All of these school systems are not exactly the same size. The one we're in is much larger. So it's a suburban Minneapolis school system, has gone through enormous construction project in the last few years, building new high schools, building with enormous swimming pools and large football fields with stadiums, et cetera. But when I really get down to ask the questions, what I found over and over and over again is they have each dealt with their state's learning results, whatever those are. They've each dealt with the assessment process and whatever that is. But what they have each found and what they've each moved on with is the fact that the baseline is it is the curriculum and instruction that makes the difference. And so what they have done, and each of them had, each of us shared different things that are going on, but each of them have taken a look at data, have taken a look at staff, have taken a look at what's out there, even talking about something which we stopped talking about a few years ago, and that is some of those, what became a dirty word, canned programs. Like if you all remember when you went to school, well, some, most of you remember, I look at ages here, some of you might remember from my day, when we taught reading as a spiraling reading curriculum. That kind of got lost in the last few years. They began to talk more about that. They began to have other ideas of things that are available out there. I know that Sarah and I came back extremely excited about some of the possibilities for Cape Elizabeth, and we were able to offer some exciting possibilities for other school systems as well. But I think the difference is we often go to conferences in different places, but there's always that very general focus on the big picture. This really helped us narrow the picture and begin to take a look at looking at teacher leadership, getting teachers truly involved in what education is all about. I think oftentimes teachers begin to feel like, you know, it's the state telling us what to do, it's the federal government telling us what to do, sometimes it's the administration telling us what to do, and we're never consulted. And so it really talked about building professional learning communities and beginning to take a look at some of those things that are out there that are programs that we could offer that would continually strengthen where we are at this point. So when I think of a program like Reading Recovery, which is at the first grade level and the struggles we're having to preserve that at the state level right now, I listen to other programs that are out there that offer enormous opportunities for young people. So from the perspective of Cape Elizabeth belonging to this group, I think it was a wise move, and I have to be honest with you, I knew nothing about it until I went out there and met. It was a very intense couple of days, but I learned a lot, and I made contacts with people who have been very helpful, that I call them up, I email them, and new information is ready for us. I think one of the more exciting things that I got from two of those systems is their plan, their futures plan that they use. And we have received those to take a look at as we begin to take a look at our next steps with the futures plan. Mm-hmm.
I can't tell you how excited I am that we were able to continue with the consortium. I know that that was originally started by Cape Elizabeth and Tom Frisella. So it's just good that we're still able to participate with those schools, and it is part of the future directions, and it is one of the particular objectives, which is to be able to measure ourselves and share collegially with other high-performing schools. So we have a lot to benefit in addition to a lot to share. So thank you for taking the time to go out and participate. At this point, we're going to move on to committee reports. We'll start off with Finance Committee. Kathy?
Thank you. The Finance Committee met on Tuesday, September 27th at 12:30 in the Superintendent's office. The committee signed warrants and reviewed appropriations reports. We had a visitor of Connie Goldman, and she briefed us on the current status of the EPS funding situation in Augusta. She indicated that targeted funds model is problematic. There will also be forthcoming a written piece on the use of targeted funds for technology, and any monies not used will be forfeited. Connie also commented on Maine's local assessment system as being the most cumbersome in the country, and she is looking to promote streamlining it. Rebecca spoke with Connie about the ramp-up versus EPS model, and she and Connie are going to get together to go over the details. I don't know if you wanted to.
We're meeting Friday.
Thank you. And Connie also encouraged us to look into regionalization, especially on transportation, in terms of expense savings. Connie also spoke about Sue Gendron going to the legislature to inquire about energy relief, which may not need to go through the budget process. Ernie McVane attended the meeting, and he reviewed the energy management projects that have been completed, are in process, and yet to be done. And I believe I distributed a list to the rest of the board members of those items. This list was generated from an evaluation of the mechanical systems done by Harriman Associates in 1999. The five top energy savers for the school system have been the variable speed drives installed in the boiler room at the high school, the parking lot lights being put on the computerized energy management system, the energy management burner control system installed in all schools, and the domestic hot water boiler installed for summer use. Oh, and one other, the replacement of the locker room rooftop air exchanger. Pauline Portria and Ernie put together, per the request of the committee, a Cape Elizabeth School Department energy cost summary, which lists all of the different types of energy use. There has been some discussion as to whether to include the pool energy costs, and she has recalculated and gotten a new one distributed, and I believe I got that one out to everybody. We also looked at generating a new report which shows monthly usage versus budgetary items so that we can be on top of where things stand and where we might be losing ground. We also talked about the former food service task force, which we had last year, being incorporated into the finance committee with a continued monthly reporting versus a separate food service task force. And I wanted to bring that up for a vote this evening, if that meets with your approval. And there will be a town council meeting on October 20th with the auditors at 7:30 p.m., I believe, here at the council chambers. Oh, in the conference room out back. And the next finance committee meeting will be held on October 25th at 12:30 in the superintendent's office. Questions? Thank you.
Thank you. A report from the planning committee. They met on September 26th for the first time in a while. We reviewed the original charge and really discussed what the direction scope of the planning committee needs to be for the school board and how it relates to both the future directions and the finance committee and their budgeting charge. We reviewed the old plan, and we did receive some feedback from all the administrators, and we decided that Alan was going to work on meshing them all together, and then we were going to start the process of how we were going to accomplish those goals, which would entail a review pretty much of all programs and their continued effectiveness. It basically comes down to, you know, is it a financial plan that supports the future directions and our vision? And it's going to take some time and a lot of input on the part of school board and administrators. And we'll get that rolling. Our next meeting, again, is on Monday, October 17th, 1 o'clock. Our next committee report would be the policy committee. And Trish is going to speak about the substance abuse policy review.
The Substance Abuse Policy Subcommittee met on Tuesday, September 27th, as has been widely reported in the press. We sort of reviewed what our strategy was. It's the first of a series of meetings where we will be focusing on different aspects of the policy. Self-referral was the primary topic of conversation. We really discussed it at length, sort of in a roundtable format of the concept of the self-referral, pros and cons. We will continue our discussion on that and then sort of extend that discussion a little bit in terms of the consequences at our next meeting on Tuesday, October 25th at 8 a.m. Basically, what we're doing is we're having a series of meetings and we're going to be discussing, as I said, the different aspects of the policy. Some of them recommended by the students, as Connor Hankinson mentioned, are a little bit different than what's in the policy, and we're dedicating a meeting to each of those different topics and then do the revision of the policy as necessary. And we'd welcome the public's comments on that if at some point we'll have some type of forum, but as we go through the process, we certainly don't want to exclude anyone. So if anyone has any comments or opinions they wish to share, they're encouraged to do so.
Thank you. Personnel Committee met on September 29th. I believe everybody received via email all the goals that were developed at that meeting along with our minutes. The first priority that came out of that committee for work over the next month would be for us to develop a tool for the superintendent evaluation. We went over a rather condensed timeline in which we're hoping that on November 1st, we will have an approval of that tool and an opportunity to meet with Alan on some of the goals, and that will all precede the vote in December for his renewal. We had our workshop on evaluation last Tuesday. The administrator negotiations have started. Teachers with Kathy and Ann as negotiators will start, I believe, next month.
Didn't tell you. Actually, we have a preparation meeting this Thursday at 1:15 in Alan's office.
Okay. So that's starting, and we will also be working before the end of the year on getting the job descriptions to the school board, as they are an integral part of some of the negotiations. So that's where we are on personnel. I get to choose the next one, don't I? let's see, we are moving to Communications Committee. Rebecca.
Okay, well, we had our first meeting, and we have two new members, Margaret Welch and Sarah Hollowell, and it's wonderful to have them on board. They've got great enthusiasm and some good ideas. Basically, what the meeting involved was just kind of going through our goals and objectives and discussing which areas we wanted to focus on implementation. And I think the big push is just to get the teachers to communicate any wonderful projects or events that they alone or with the students are involved in, and sharing that with me or Trish so we can make sure that we can get maybe some information out to the public. We discussed continuing to work amongst our own activities for several months and then meeting on a quarterly basis, therefore trying to alleviate one more meeting for our staff to attend. So I think our next meeting is in January.
That's it. Thank you. The Athletic Committee, I will be introducing under new business the opportunity for us to vote on the establishment of the Athletic Co-Curricular Committee to be a new standing committee of the school board. This committee will have the Athletic Steering Committee, the existing one as it stands, chaired by Keith Weatherby, reporting to that committee. And they will continue to review the existing programs and evaluate new programs and develop the athletic budget. Also, under this committee umbrella will be the co-curricular committee and also the temporary committee, so to speak, on sports done right. And we need to bring that all under umbrella so that we can bring that to fruition for the community. But at this point, there's just myself serving on this, and Kevin had asked via an email that we wait on the appointment of another board member. I know he did put out a request for those who might be interested in being on this committee. If we can just establish the committee, we could probably get started and have the appointment sometime in the next month. So if anyone has any strong feelings about that committee, again, make sure you get in touch with Kevin. A legislative liaison. Rebecca, do you have anything to report there?
No, I think I have put out the question to the board as to whether we wanted to take a position on the SAT, but we were going to wait to hear from our administration as to how they felt. I think we actually got that answer this evening, so I don't see that probably we're going to issue any statement. But please feel free to bring up anything to the board, and I'd be willing to help contact the right people or write a position paper for us as a board.
Okay. We also have several appointments and advisory committees. The Cape Elizabeth Education Foundation met on September 19th for their board meeting. They are taking a look now at the fall professional development grants that they are granting, so to speak. We also received an update from Jeff on the Achievement Center. They also updated the rest of the board on their very successful start to their capital campaign. And they also had a successful event on September 29th that a lot of the board members and town council members attended at Dave and Beverly Sherman's home, again, to attract some people who are interested in hearing about Steve's work and their plans for the future success. So I do want to just point out that Kevin Sweeney did send an email to the foundation that did not get to the foundation. It came through myself, and I just want to publicly say that he apologized for not being able to attend that event, and that he again supported everything that they provide for the Cape Elizabeth schools, and that he appreciates their help, but he wanted them to understand it wasn't he wasn't uninterested or whatever. So and then lastly, the town comp plan committee is meeting on the fourth Thursday evening of every month, and their last meeting was on September 22nd, in which we had a very long meeting, but very productive meeting, going through all the questionnaire pieces as to housing, schools, you know, development of paths, conserving land. And it is going to be developed by Critical Insights, and it will be a telephone survey. I think I sent out an email to everybody that's a newspaper article that will be explaining to the public that over the next 2 weeks, they're going to be making 400 phone calls to a very random and very specifically profiled group of people from Cape Elizabeth asking these questions. It will take approximately 15 minutes, and they are really encouraging people to not hang up. And if it is not a good time, they will also still request that they choose a time and follow up with their questions and hopefully answers, so that they can fulfill their obligation in getting a very statistical, reliable cross-section of Cape Elizabeth. But that's pretty much what they've done. We will be meeting next week, and we'll be working on population and demographic projections. And like I said, this is an 18-month process, so they are making great strides as far as gathering the information. The last thing is that there will be the very first of what I believe is going to be three public forums, and that will be on December 8th here in Town Council Chambers at 7 o'clock, and Critical Insights will be reporting some of the initial results of the survey. But more importantly, they will also be looking for people to share outside of the survey their thoughts on where they would like to see Cape Elizabeth be in the next 10 years. So that's it. We're going to move on to unfinished business. We don't need to do anything at this point on the trips to Costa Rica until we have the liability information. New business would be a consideration of the superintendent's recommendation for athletic fee positions for the winter of 2005.
The first list you have in front of you is from Keith Weatherby, and these are winter coaching recommendation. There is a fairly long list of these. I don't know whether you want me to read those first, or if you want to move on from there.
If you could read all of them, and then we'll vote on them as a whole.
Okay. The first one is Jim Ray, who is in his 19th year as varsity boys basketball coach. Jerry McQueenie, sixth year as JV boys basketball. Chris Haywood, second year freshman boys basketball. Ron Kierstead, fourth year varsity girls basketball. Robert Kierstead, second year JV girls basketball. Doug Worthley, 10th year of varsity indoor track. David Weatherby, third year assistant indoor track. Paul Snyder, third year assistant indoor track, and Mark Joyce, third year assistant indoor track. Carrie Curtis, 13th year of varsity girls and boys swimming. Mike Bartlett, second year of as diving coach. Ben Raymond, 11th year as varsity assistant swim coach. Devin Morrell, fourth year of varsity Nordic ski. Jason Tremblay, second year of ice hockey. And Joseph Robinson, second year assistant ice hockey coach.
Could I have a motion for the superintendent's recommendation for these athletic fees positions?
So moved.
Thank you. Is there a second? Any discussion?
I'd like to recuse myself because I have an extended family member on that list.
Okay. Any other further comments? All those in favor? 4-0 with one recuse. Okay.
I also have one other one that you added to the agenda. That is from Keith also. This is an additional recommendation for a coach for the fall 2005 season. This is Derek Curtis, who has been the assistant football coach. Somehow he was left off the original list. So a request to have him recommended for assistant football coach in the season that is about to end.
Okay. I have a motion.
So moved.
Thank you, Trish. A second?
Seconded.
Thank you, Henry. All those in favor? I'm sorry, I missed something. Would you like to make a comment?
Can we avoid that happening? I feel like this is crazy that we're voting on something that was already out of the season.
Apparently it was an oversight.
Oh, so this should have been in the first group.
It should have been in the first
summer.
Group, but yes.
Okay,
and
sorry.
It's something that's paid by the boosters. And it was just an oversight on their part, and they apologized.
I know we've had that discussion about trying to improve the lead time on the athletic and some of our new hires.
But I understand mistakes are made.
Okay. So all those in favor of this nomination? Henry?
No.
5-0, thank you. Consideration of the superintendent's recommendations for co-curricular fee positions for the 05-06 year.
Again, I have a fairly long list here. Do you want me to read that also?
Yes,
okay.
I think so.
This is agenda item 12B, co-curricular fee recommendations at the middle school. 7th and 8th grade math team. Brian Ficchero. Computer club, also Brian Ficchero. Drama, director Evan Solander, and lighting is Steve Price, sound is Tom Wilbur, and music is Kristen Thomas. Marguerite Lala Roner, Susan Quirk, who is the general assistant in drama. 5th and 6th grade math team is Solander. Student council is Jim Dolliner and Katie Fairbanks Cliff. Those are the middle school ones. I also have high school. 9th grade advisors, budgeted stipend equally shared between Sean Garrett, Bill Blake, and science club is Sean Garrett. System-wide mentors for teachers is required by certification rules. Lynn Spattinger for Mary Jen Amberger for Lisa Sherman, Amy Kieran for Nicole Ball. Susie Safer for Morgan Burns, Sarah Lewis for Taylor Edlund, Susan Mishu for Sarah Hollowell, Teresa Roberts for Sarah Welch, Suzanne Janelle for Amy Matthews, Mary Murphy for Melissa Sullivan, Elaine Brownell for Bill Blake, Bill Brewington for Sue Garrett, Michael Efron for Sean Garrett, Kathy Hamlin for Karen Cronin, Kathy Hamlin also for Rob Thompson, Belinda Snell for Brandy LaPointe, Nancy Murphy for Matt Clements, Tom Robinson for Beth Milroy, Hannah Jones for Lisa Melanson, and Mary Hart for Karen Dyer, second semester only. Those are the only ones I have.
Okay, thank you. Can I have a motion to accept these recommendations?
So moved.
Thank you, Kathy. A second? Rebecca? Any comments?
I just have two questions, actually, for clarification. I know many of these people do this out of the goodness of their heart, but how do these people volunteer? Do they apply? Are they appointed? They're technically, since we're paying them, I don't want to say employees, some of them are, but how does one get to be a co-curricular director? That'd be my first question. And just for clarification, do we pay a stipend to the mentors?
Yes. They're paid $700 for a great deal of work.
I'm sure. And I prefaced it. I know many of these do that. Many of these people do it out of the goodness of their heart, but I'm just curious to know what the process is. It's in terms of becoming a co-curricular person.
Do you have any more you want to say about the mentors? And I'll check with Jeff and Steve.
As far as how we get the mentors, we just make it known among the teachers that we need mentors for the new teachers who are either who are not professional level teachers. They're either provisional, conditional, transitional. It's determined by their certification. And we try our very best to get a volunteer from their grade level or a subject level so that it would be most meaningful for the teacher who's being mentored. It is required by state law that we provide mentors for these teachers who are not professionally certified. If you have any other questions.
Oh, that's clear. That's very helpful. Thank you.
And then from the perspective of co-curricular at the middle school and high school.
These are all one-year positions. And so in the spring of each year, I essentially put out a list of all the open positions, which is all of them, and ask for people who are interested in applying. And see what comes forward. Where there are more than one person who's interested, I will meet with those folks and try to get a sense of whether there's a match, what the experience is and background is, and try to get the best person possible. So that's the way.
And as you may be aware, Trish, some of the names on the list, some people are volunteers and some people are forced volunteers.
Yes. I know people do this out of the goodness of their heart. I just was curious, as we're approving these positions that we're paying, just what the process is.
But I believe, though, there's also, this falls under the co-curricular committee of the school board. And from time to time, every so many years, they do a lot of work, which is establishing the number of hours for that co-curricular event. And what the stipend will be.
I recall doing that last spring, but we never really got into how people become, you know, that person. And we did spend, so that I was just curious to know in terms of how people get into the slot.
Okay. Great. Any further discussion? All those in favor? 5-0. A consideration of the superintendent's recommendation for school physician.
What you have in front of you is that Dr. Jeff Safer Dr. Jeff Safer has served in that capacity for a number of years. And as noted here, State Law 20A, Section 6402A, requires that we appoint one or more school physicians. Therefore, I'm bringing to you Dr. Safer's name. And he would, upon approval, would receive an annual stipend of $1,000.
Thank you. Do I have a motion for this item?
I move that we approve the superintendent's recommendation of Jeffrey Safer as a school physician.
Thank you. A second? Rebecca, any discussion?
Can I just ask what that position does?
I think basically it's a consultation position. In other words, if the nurses have questions around treatment of students, et cetera, that he is available for those consultations. I don't believe, and I could be wrong, but I don't believe he comes into the schools and does direct services. And I look at Pauline.
No.
It's consultation only, am I correct? Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. All those in favor? 5-0. requests from high school social studies teacher regarding the three field trips that we heard about earlier. Do we want to vote on these separately or all three of them together? I guess would be my first question of the board. I have a tendency to say we would vote for all three unless someone has an objection to that and wants to vote on them separately.
No, they were pretty well explained.
Yeah.
Okay. Do I have a motion to have the approval of this of these three field trips with Ted Jordan?
I move that we approve for him to move forward for future final approval upon completion of the insurance question.
Great. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Kathy. Any discussion? Okay. All those in favor? 5-0. A request from the high school natural helpers regarding their field trip, which was the day trip, it was the 3-day trip. Do I have a motion for that?
Will that fall in the same? I don't know. Do I move it and then ask the question?
Yeah.
I move that we approve the high school natural helpers field trip.
Thank you. A second? Rebecca, further discussion?
Actually, my motion probably should have been the same as Rebecca's because it's pending liability insurance situation, right?
Because I'm not sure, I just read that again. I'm not sure whether they're going by school. Oh, yes, would leave by bus on November 8th, but I'm not sure. Is that school bus?
Transportation, because it's in-state, it's strictly by school bus. Okay. It used to be in Sanford, it's now in Winthrop by
yes.
So my understanding at that point, I look to Pauline because she's done research on this before. Therefore, since it's by school bus, it is a school sponsored event, then our liability would cover that. Am I correct?
Yes.
Okay. So the motion as
stands.
So are there any further questions? All right. Being none, all those in favor of the natural helpers trip? 5-0. Thank you. Consideration of the superintendent's nomination to middle school physical education teaching position for the remainder of the 05-06 school year.
As you know, Sarah is out on maternity leave going into unpaid leave of absence for the remainder of the year. Steve advertised the position, had several applications, if I'm not mistaken, Steve, quite a few, and has presented to me this candidate who is unbelievable qualifications for someone who we're looking for a substitute. Her name is Gina Rossi. I did have her application, at least her resume put in here so you could take a look at it. But she is highly qualified for the position. And I know in talking with Steve that he and his committee were extremely excited about her as the candidate. So my recommendation is to hire her for the remainder of the school year. And just as a reminder to all of you, when we're hiring somebody for the remainder of the school year and we're not at the half year point, she will be under contract for the remainder of that year. If it were after the half year point, then we could look at a substitute, although a substitute can only work 60 days in sequence. So this would be a contract to complete the rest of the year.
I have a motion.
I move that we accept the superintendent's nomination for middle school physical education teaching position of Gina Rossi.
Thank you. A second? Thank you, Henry. Any discussion, questions? Seeing none, all those in favor? 5-0. We have the additional items of the special education position, tech
yes.
position.
This would be 12G. As you remember, there was a presentation and a letter from Claire talking about the fact that we picked up 17 new special education students. Claire worked very, very diligently with her staff looking at the placement of those 17 students to make some determinations on what we should do. Initially, we looked at it, or she looked at it and reported back to me that she didn't think we would need that position. However, after a more serious look at it again, first serious look, and then the second serious look, and I met with Claire and the staff, it was determined that we truly do need a half-time person in that position. So tonight, what I am asking you is to give us the go-ahead to open a half-time position, which would cost approximately $12,140. And that is reached looking at the date of hire, and the date of hire we had on that is 10/11. It could be beyond that. We looked at, and Pauline gave me the information about the half of a salary, then prorated from there, then looking at approximate cost of the health benefits. So the $12,140 would be for a half-time, less 29 days if it were happening today. And that included full health benefits of $12,715, again, prorated both by the 29 days and the half a year. Did I do that right? All right. Right on.
Now, can I have a motion for consideration of the superintendent's recommendation on this position?
So moved.
Thank you, Henry. A second? Trish? Any further questions or discussion?
Just a question, how, in terms of our budget, is this handled?
I had talked with Pauline. I don't know, Pauline, if you want to answer that from the discussion we had.
It will come from the salary account.
Again, from the savings that we had during last year.
And staff changes.
Thank you.
Okay. Any further questions?
I would just ask one. Claire is sitting right there. Claire, I know you've been interviewing. Do you have a possible candidate for this position?
Yes, we do.
Okay.
So I guess the motion would be for just the hiring of someone to come, the allocation of money for this position.
Go ahead.
The school board has never approved or never, we have never brought an ed tech candidate to the school board. The superintendent has appointed those positions.
So it would be approval for this position.
This half-time position.
Okay.
Thank you, Claire.
I've lost track where we are. Did we have a motion?
You have a motion and a second.
Second and discussion. And
discussion.
Okay. So all those in favor of the establishing of this position for the 05-06 school year? That would be 5-0. Thank you. Lastly, we have a consideration of the establishment of a new standing committee called the Athletic Co-Curricular Committee for the school board. Do I have a motion?
I move that we establish an Athletic Co-Curricular Committee. Have under it reporting the Athletic Steering Committee, the Co-Curricular Steering Committee, and the Sports Done Right Task Force.
Great. Thank you. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Thank you, Henry. Any further questions or comments?
Just a quick question. Is it athletic co-curricular or, I mean, the list of co-curricular that we did before, there are no athletic positions on it. Which co-curricular? I don't know.
And co-curricular. So it would be a committee that would hear from the co-curricular committee.
Okay, so the co-curricular committee reports to this committee.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Okay.
And then they would report back to the whole school board based on the work they would do. All those in favor? Or are there further questions? You look puzzled, Rebecca.
I'm sorry, I do. I'm now confused. The co-curricular committee, is there a school board member on that? Is that a school board member, school board committee? Or is that a school?
It's not a standing committee. It's there's a school board member on that committee, it's just as it is, just like the athletic steering committee. And it's made up of administrators, I believe, and some of the teachers.
That's what I thought.
And that's why it's coming under that umbrella of a school board committee.
It comes under, it's membership is defined in the contract between the teachers and the school board, the negotiated agreement.
All right. Any further comments or questions?
Following up on that, though, then, is it appropriate and acceptable in the contract for that to be a school board for their...
I don't believe that, I don't know why I'm answering the question, but I don't believe there's anything in the contract that forbids that coming under another committee. You're not disbanding the committee, you're just asking it to report to a school committee, standing committee. The same as the athletic steering committee is defined by the negotiated agreement.
So it's not changing its status? It's not a standing committee of the school board?
They always report to the school board ultimately anyhow.
Right, that's why I'm just wondering what the rationale is for having to report to the athletic committee. We're reporting just the co-curricular piece. I understand the other, and I completely support that. I guess I'm just, it seems to me it's one more level of administration, if you will. If we're not changing the status of the co-curricular committee.
I think the purpose is that we're trying to do a little consolidation of committees and get them under the auspices of an oversight committee. And so what we would like to create is the athletic and co-curricular committee, which would be the oversight committee. And then those three would work under that. We will also be working on that same thing. And I know Kathy had a comment on another committee that she'd like to move into finance as well. But that's really the basis of that. Instead of having massive committees out there, mm-hmm. we can get them a little more coordinated.
Thank you. Point where we'll take a vote. All those in favor of the establishment of this standing committee? 5-0. Thank you. At this point, I'm asking if there's any public comment for non-agenda items.
I didn't think to add this before, but could I add a potential vote on the food service task force being folded into the finance committee?
I don't see any reason why not. I would.
Well, then I'd like to propose that the food service task force be folded in and become part of the finance committee for the finance committee to follow up on.
Makes sense. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Thank you. A second? A second on that first motion? Thank you, Henry. Any questions or comments?
Just a technicality, because we set up that food service task force as a temporary committee. Are we eliminating it and disbanding it? I mean, don't we have to do that and then charge the finance committee with monitoring the food service? I don't. Just in terms of committee structure, if we're trying to clean things up, we set that up as a temporary committee. I think we need to disband it. And that may be effectively what you're doing.
Yes, or you may be right, it maybe has to be done in two steps. I don't know.
And I don't know, I wasn't here for the history of it. Pauline, is there anything that you can add to that?
It was a task force, so it was a temporary committee. And I think it's a good idea to disband it and have it under the charge of the finance committee to report out on food service.
And I think the idea was that the finance committee continues to follow the mm-hmm. progress and it doesn't get disbanded and forgotten.
Okay. Thank you, Pauline, for that history. I think at this point, do we want to table this for this motion for consideration at our next meeting so that we can go ahead and have a motion to dissolve the task force first? I believe, do you have to do that officially?
I think I would assume, I don't know what the minutes say, but I would assume that task force was established officially through the minutes.
I have to check back at the minutes.
Maybe
I don't remember.
I believe it was. And check it.
Check
it was? Okay, Pauline says that it was established, so then you would have to disband it through a motion as well.
And should that be done now, or should...
So I make a motion to table my motion.
Table your original motion.
Table my original, can I table my original motion without a second?
Why don't we do
a second?
Henry
seconded.
But I want to now table it.
Okay, thank you. All those in favor of tabling this motion? 5-0. We have a new motion?
Yes. I would like to make a motion that the Food Service Task Force be dissolved. And the responsibilities that the Food Service Task Force was performing last year become part of the responsibilities of the current Finance Committee.
Thank you, Henry. Any further discussion or comments? All those in favor? 5-0.
Thank you.
And at this point, are there any school board agenda requests for the next meeting that we can leave for Kevin and Ann? There being none, the announcement of the upcoming meetings. The Planning Committee will meet on Monday, October 17th, 1 p.m. in the William Jordan Conference Room. Policy Committee meeting will meet Tuesday, October 18th at 12 noon in the William Jordan Conference Room. Personnel Committee will meet Monday, October 24th, 1 p.m. In the Superintendent's Office. The Substance Abuse Committee will meet on Tuesday, October 25th at 8 a.m. at the William Jordan Conference Room. Finance Committee meeting will be Tuesday, October 25th at 12:30 p.m. in the Superintendent's Office. Our next school board workshop will be Tuesday, November 1st, 7 p.m. This will be in the Council Chambers, and the topics will be athletics and sports done right. Our school board business meeting will be Tuesday, November 8th, right here in Council Chambers at 7 o'clock. How do you adjourn the meeting? This meeting is over. Thank you. Yes.